fighting and speaking out about the effects of nutrition on disease for over 20 years. He believes that
20.
People should look and feel great and enjoy optimal health, which is something that we talk about a lot here at Smart Life Forum, for a lifetime. Unfortunately, some people compromise their health unknowingly through poor dietary habits. Dr. McDougall is the founder and medical director of the nationally renowned McDougall Program, a 10-day residential program located at a luxury resort in Santa Rosa, California, a place where medical miracles occur through proper diet and lifestyle changes. Dr. McDougall has cared for thousands of patients over almost three decades of medical practice, and has run a highly successful live-in program for more than 17 years. He has developed a nourishing, low-fat, starch-based diet that not only promotes a broad range of dramatic and lasting health benefits, such as weight loss and weight and fat loss, but most importantly, can reverse serious illnesses,
help people gain weight,
such as heart disease, without drugs. As with many leaders of public opinion, he often finds it necessary to challenge the accepted wisdom of the time. And he was one of the first traditional physicians of the medical establishment, establishment in quotes, to assert that adoption of a vegetarian diet can reverse unfavorable medical conditions such as heart disease. Medical research is now confirming this assertion, and slowly but surely medical practitioners are accepting it. Dr. McDougall is the author of several national bestsellers, including the McDougall Plan, 12 Days to Dynamic Health, McDougall's Medicine, A Challenging Second Opinion, the McDougall Program for Maximum Weight Loss, the new McDougall Cookbook, the McDougall Program for Women, and his latest groundbreaking book, The McDougall Program for a Healthy Heart. A graduate of Michigan State University's College of Human Medicine, he performed his internship at Queens Medical Center in Honolulu, Hawaii, and his medical residency at the University of Hawaii. He is certified as an internist by the Board of Internal Medicine and the National Board of Medical Examiners. To make it easier for people to eat well on the go, Dr. McDougall co-founded Dr. McDougall's Right Foods Incorporated, a producer of high-quality vegetarian cuisine. The convenience meals are consistent with his health-supporting guidelines of 10% or less calories from fat, strictly vegetarian, so there's no cholesterol and no added oils. Dr. McDougall is chairman of the company. And I would also like to mention that he is accompanied by his wife and partner, Mary, who's here tonight, in fact. And it's with great pleasure that I introduce tonight's guest speaker, Dr. John McDougall.
Well, thank you for the invitation. I noticed all of you have a lot of opinions. So I do too. I have very strong opinions. And you can make it fun for me if you challenge me along the way. I miss that a lot. You know, I talk and I get very little feedback. So, you know, I'm going to tell you how I feel about things. And I've been at this for a little longer than 20 years, probably closer to 30. I like doing what I do because the results that I get as a doctor, you know, that's really the fun in life, is helping other people. And I'll explain to you why I don't practice medicine like I was trained and why I practice like I do. And I'm going to make a lot of qualifications, and I hope I remember to do that along the way, to make qualifications so that I don't overspeak the situation. Sometimes I get so enthused about what I do that I generalize. And you know, I guess that's a habit a lot of people have. But I'll try and stop along the way and tell you that I am realistic and do realize, for example, this first slide up here says something about the limitations of modern medicine. It does have some serious limitations, but it also has some serious benefits. Like, for example, if I get in an auto accident, I don't want you to come up to me with a baked potato and a carrot and say, this is your treatment tonight. Okay, I fully realize that modern medicine has some wonderful things to offer when it comes to infections and traumas and other things. So if I if I make some glowing statements tonight about the failing of modern medicine, realize that I understand there's some very, very wonderful things. I also feel strongly about the benefits of self-care. And I think more and more people are coming to that realization is that it really is how we take care of ourselves that makes a difference in terms of the outcome. And I'm going to try and share that with you tonight. When Bill asked me to talk to this group, I wasn't really quite sure what I should talk to you about. My first inclination, I was going to give you a talk about dairy products, which is on that DVD. And I had several other different thoughts about what I should talk to you about. And instead, what I thought I would do is put together kind of a generalization of what I do so you can get sort of the tone. Now, some of you might sit back there and say, well, you know, I'd rather be talked to in terms of scientific references, in terms of data, in terms of hard science. I can go hard science with you all day long, okay? You know, my passion is the scientific literature. So if you want to take and step on that track, I'll be glad to with you. It's no problem at all. But instead, what I'd like to do is I'd kind of like to give you just a feel of what I do, some generalizations of how I believe and the kind of practice that I have. You know, I consider myself the luckiest doctor in the world because of how my patients do. The situation is really sad out there in the United States of America. It's a situation where annually in this country we have 1.2 million heart attacks, 700,000 strokes. Most Americans are sick. I mean, it's an exception to find a healthy person. Most Americans over the age of 35, I mean almost all of them, with few exceptions, have a risk factor that says that they're going to die prematurely of a heart attack, stroke, cancer, complications of diabetes, and so on. We live in a country where a third of the people have elevated cholesterol by today's standards. Today's standards are really, I think, excessive. If you use the standards that I use, you'd probably be up around 98% of them have elevated cholesterols. Most are inactive. A third have high blood pressure, again, by today's standards. More than 30% are obese, and they tell us that 65% of people, and you don't have to go any further than the next shopping center to confirm this, you don't need a scientific study, 65% of people are too fat for their own good, right? And 10% of people are diabetic. So we live in a nation where almost everybody is sick. Now, how do you explain that? It's a rarity to find a healthy person. How do you explain that? Yeah, probably the chlorines in the water, right? Yeah, almost everybody is sick in this country. And so we have to, you know, take a broad sweep as the possibilities. I mean, is it a genetic problem? Is it a contamination, as was mentioned by our last speaker? Is it maybe a massive viral infection that nobody's discovered? What's the problem? Let me talk to you about the treatment of my patients and one of the problems I have with the medical system. This is one of my patients. And he has a diagnosis, and I'm not exaggerating. You know, most of the people that I take care of at the clinic come in with a series of problems, not just one problem, but a series of problems. He comes in with high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, elevated cholesterol, elevated triglycerides. He has gout. His kidneys are already failing. He's overweight, mild osteoarthritis, constipated and depressed. Okay? You think this is an exaggeration? How many of you are doctors here? How many of you see people like this all day long? Okay, this is a typical person. All right. Now, I met him a couple of years ago. He decided not to become involved with my medical practice, and so he decided to go out and get good medical care. And so he went to a local doctor. And he visited the doctor every month, paid his monthly fee to the doctor's office, took his prescriptions, bought his medications, followed directions right to the T, was a very compliant patient, and he came back to see me 2 years later, and here's a picture of 2 years later. Okay? Now, he still has high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, elevated cholesterol, elevated triglycerides, gout, mild kidney failure, overweight, Okay, I have a serious question for you. What has changed in 2 years?
Sure.
His wallet's smaller, his shirt's different. Okay, what I want to tell you, what I want you to notice, and I don't care, you don't have to relate to this guy. I want you to think about Aunt Millie, or your mother, or your brother, or your best friend, who went to the doctor 2 years faithfully and did everything they said. What is different about them 2 years later? Nothing. Nothing. They're still fat and sick. They're just carrying around a bag full of drugs. Stop. Stop me if I'm incorrect about this. You tell me of patients that you know that something different happened than that. I don't. That's why I don't practice the kind of medicine I used to. I don't know of a doctor who can claim otherwise. Okay, let me ask you about good medical care. You guys, you be the doctor for a minute, okay? Say you're the doctor and a patient comes in with a terrible cough, wheezing, gunk coming out of their lungs, and you find out that they have a little habit. And so you, as the prescribing doctor, what do you do for this person? Do you prescribe smokers vitamins? Cough syrups? Is that your prescription, cough syrup? What do you do for this person? Okay. You obviously do this, don't you? You tell them to quit smoking. Okay, this person comes in to see you. All right? What do you do for them? You prescribe vitamins for their liver failure. You prescribe antabuse for their alcoholism. What is your primary treatment for these people? What do you do for them? Okay, now you agree with me. I mean, stop me. I mean, if I'm getting off track, stop me. You're the doctor. You agree with me that anybody who would treat a patient otherwise would be considered irresponsible, correct? All right, this person comes in your office. What do you do with them? How do you treat them? Every single doctor in your community, without exception, I'm talking about...
Why don't I treat you?
Okay.
It's all set. It'll go on when I turn the sound up.
Okay. Thanks. Except for some of the doctors that you may know, the standard practice of medicine is to do what with these people? To fill them full of bag full of drugs. Whereas what should you be doing? Just like with the smoker and the alcoholic, what would you do with these people if you were a good doctor? You'd stop the cause of their problem, but this is almost never done. I used to be at St. Helena Hospital. I was there for 16 years. I practiced at St. Helena Hospital, which is, by the way, one of the most respected hospitals in California. It's number two in terms of bypass surgery and other heart surgeries up in the Napa Valley. 80% of the income of the hospital comes from heart disease. I was a thorn in their side. But I did remain there for 16 years. And there were various things that caused me to leave. And if you read the China study, there are four pages about me in the China study. And that's one of the episodes that caused me to leave. But here's another one that's not in that book that I'd like to share with you. There are noontime conferences every week that are put on by the drug companies. And the drug companies, they pay for the doctor's lunches because you can't expect the doctor to shell out $2.50 for their own lunch. Now, this does not influence your doctor, nor do the prescription pads or the donuts or the other things these companies spend. You know, you ask your doctor and they'll tell you that. Well, anyways, I don't go to those noontime conferences for obvious reasons. But one day I read on the schedule the title of a lecture that really intrigued me. It said, diabetes is caused by fat, not sugar. And I said, finally, somebody's got this figured out. And so I gathered all of my staff from the health center at St. Helena Hospital. I said, we've got to go hear this person. So we arrived at the noontime conference. I walked in, and the first suggestion that there was going to be a problem was the fact that the Pfizer guy was sitting in the back of the room. The next problem was the speaker walked in, and he was obese, full of pimples, and had a ponytail. Now, there's nothing wrong with the ponytail, but the other two things gave me a clue that I was going to have some problems. So I listened to this man speak for an hour, and he got done, and I said, I heard you talk about how to properly take care of a diabetic. And I said, during this hour presentation, I said, I counted it. You listed 20 drugs that we used to properly treat a diabetic, and I said, you used a very sexy term called polypharmacology. I mean, how could any doctor resist being a polypharmacist? I said, but there's a problem. I said, the title of your lecture is Diabetes is Caused by Fat, Not Sugar. I said, I didn't hear you mention diet once in this whole lecture. He says, I got you here, didn't I? I said, yeah, you got me here. I said, but there's a problem. I said, of the drugs you listed to treat these people, some of these drugs kill people. I started naming them off, like the oral hypoglycemics, the sulfonylureas, and the calcium channel blockers. And then the head of my health center got up and apologized for my behavior. He said, well, you have to understand, Dr. McDougall, he writes these health food books and so on and so on. And he's a very politically correct guy, you know, he did it very nicely. And so I'm walking out of the room with this head of the health center, his name is John Hodgkin. I'm walking out of the room and I looked at him and I said, John, you know, our colleagues don't believe this is the way you properly take care of a patient, do they? He said, yes, we do. I said, I don't want to be that kind of doctor anymore. That was one of the decisions that caused me to leave, one of the events. There are many of them, and one of them is also told in the China study, which is at least as dramatic. There's a book that sits on every doctor's desk. You all recognize this? Okay, it's called The Physician's Desk Reference. Now, in this book, they have categories of disease, like antibiotics, which, by the way, are wonderful, wonderful drugs. They cure disease, and you'd certainly want to get them if you had a very bad infection. But there are also categories such as anti-diabetic. That's what it said. They're listed under anti-diabetic, and they list all of these diabetic pills. Now, I know some of you are doctors here, and of course, all of you know doctors. How many of you know of a diabetic patient who has been cured with anti-diabetic pills? Would you raise your hands? I've never met anybody. I talk at medical schools. I talk at doctor groups all over the country. And I've yet to meet a doctor who has ever seen a patient cured with anti-diabetic pills. So why prescribe them? How about antihypertensive pills? Anybody ever seen a person with high blood pressure cured of high blood pressure with antihypertensive pills? I never have. How about antiarthritic? Arthritis, ever seen anybody cured of arthritis? I never have. I never met a doctor who has, yet that's what they prescribe. How sad. It must be very disappointing to be a doctor to give out all these drugs that don't work. All right, let's talk about what does work. I mean, you can stop me along the way. I mean, if I'm exaggerating, if you don't think I'm being fair, stop me. Tell me. Okay, let's talk. Yes. Well, how about anti-arthritic pills stopping the pain? Is that good enough reason to prescribe them as the first-line therapy?
Well, it may be better than nothing.
Maybe, but maybe there's a better alternative. And to just answer your question very specifically, antihypertensive pills do not reduce the risk of heart attacks. They will reduce the risk of stroke about 1 per 1,000 per year over not treating. I don't know if you've ever gotten involved in something called relative or absolute risk. They cut your risk in half, but your risk is only like 1 in 2,000. So really your benefit is like 1 in 1,000, your absolute benefit. It's all fraud perpetrated by the drug companies and which has continued to be passed on by your doctors. So the benefits are extremely small. But it's not that these things don't do something. I'm glad you brought that up. They do something, or otherwise it'd be a real joke, right? They'd lock these people up in jail for doing this, which they might consider doing. No, there is certainly some sales pitch out there, a little bit of truth in everything, and I agree. But is there a better way of dealing with these problems? Is this what I'd like to go on to next? All right, Mary and I, you met my wife Mary back there. Mary and I were at a restaurant a while back, and we're with our son, and this lady came up to us and said, I'd like to take your picture. She had this big fancy camera, and she said, it'll be $10 for a family portrait. And I said, no, thank you. I don't really want my family's picture taken. I said, but you see this family sitting off to my left? I said, will you take their picture for me? And she went over, and she snapped the picture of this Japanese family speaking Japanese, eating primarily rice and vegetables, off to my left, and this is their picture. I said, wow, that was easy. So she came back, sold me the picture for $10. I said, hey, would you do that for me again? I said, will you take a picture of the family off to my right? And she went and took me a picture of this family speaking Pidgin English in Hawaii. Okay, same genetics. Do you notice any difference? Now, what happened to these people? I'm serious. So we hear all kinds of excuses as to why people get sick. What happened to these people? Let me offer you some possibilities. Did maybe their genetics change between the first, second, third, and fourth? You don't think they changed in 20 years, the genetics? No? Did they catch a virus? You think they caught a virus? Or do you think maybe what happened is they stopped eating so much starch, so much rice and vegetables, instead started eating more protein and fat and meat? Can you see this? It should be no mystery to anybody. Yes?
You've made some outrageous assumptions that by looking at some fat people, some thin people, you knew what they ate for the last 20 years. The Hawaiians I know eat more rice than the Japanese I know. I mean, you're using these as evidence for what you're saying isn't very scientific or even primarily rational, as far as I can tell.
Would you like to look at the whole world picture? Have you ever been to China or Japan?
I've gone from the right side of that to the left side of that by not eating rice and bread and soy.
Let me just ask you, okay? If you, any of you, stop and add in if you want. Have any of you traveled or watched travelogues to Japan, Thailand, Asia?
Yes.
Are these people fat?
No.
Do they have high rates of heart disease? Now, wait a minute.
No.
Just a minute. No. Okay. Now, when these people move, the Japanese, Chinese, people from Thai, Korea, they move to Palo Alto. What happens to them in general? Is this a mystery? Okay, you say, how about France? You want to talk about France for a minute? Okay, France is the quote, the French paradox. In France today, they have the fastest rising rate of obesity of any European country. In France today, they have the highest rate of cancer of any European country. The reason the French did so well is post-World War II, they had some pretty lean times. Oh, they're getting fatter.
All of Europe isn't fat. Once you get to the U.S. airline terminal, that's where it gets
fatter. Oh, it gets worse there, doesn't it? But England is terrible, too. Listen, I can go to the statistics with you.
Yeah.
England has a horrible obesity problem. Read The Lancet. Read the British Medical Journal.
Fair point. But the assumption that, you go ahead and get down. I don't want to derail you, but you're going to get a lot of talking questions.
Go hear the talk rather than...
I think this is... I really don't think it's a problem. Okay, we'll skip on to it. Most of you can see this, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
All right, I'm trying to give you some generalizations to show you how I feel about these things, all right? The whole China study you're holding in your hand is about this. Okay. So most people have seen this. All right, now what would happen? What say you wanted to be a doctor, treat people by this point of view. What would happen if you took the family on your right and you gave them a one-way ticket to Japan and made them live with a Japanese farming family and work in the fields?
And get more exercise.
And would they eat differently?
Yeah.
Okay, and what would happen to their health? They would lose weight, right? And their blood pressure and cholesterol and so on would go down. I mean, wouldn't it always happen that way? I would think so. Anyway, that's what my practice is about. That's all I do is I just take my patients, give them a one-way ticket to Japan. It's really no more complicated than that, honestly. And to make a bigger deal about it is just, satisfying somebody's intellect, I guess. But it's no more complicated. You take people who eat rich food, they get fat and sick. You tell them to stop eating rich food all the time, they get healthy. The problem is not, vegetables are very important, but what we run into today are people who are preaching high vegetable diets, raw diets, diets of green and yellow vegetables. You can't survive on those kinds of diets. And this is the new fad.
Not enough calories.
Not enough calories, right. You have to have a starch-based diet. All successful populations of people have lived on starch-based diets until modern times. I don't know of any exception until you get to the extremes of environment, like up in the Arctic or in the deepest parts of the jungle. We go on a lot of trips. We do something called McDougall Adventure Trips, where we take people around the world. And for example, we've done a lot of Central and South American trips. And we'll go to civilizations, non-existent civilizations, like the Inca and the Aztec and the Mayan civilization. We'll go visit their ruins. And we'll be traveling with a guide. And somewhere along the way, one of the people in our groups, because they're all, quote, McDougall followers, one of the people will say, well, what do these people eat? And they'll say, well, they lived on corn and squash and other vegetables. And how about milk? No, they never had milk. And how about meat? Well, that was just quite rare. And somebody will pipe up and say, well, they were on the McDougall diet. And again, you can go to Italy, you can go to Thailand, you can go there. It's basically a starch-based diet. So I run into people, and I hate to be, again, so dogmatic, so strong in what I'm saying, but I get a lot of people who are into all raw diets and green and yellow vegetable diets. And I'm not trying to tell you that green and yellow vegetables aren't good or that raw food isn't good, but they make that their whole diet. Well, first of all, these raw diets are basically fat and sugar. They're nuts, seeds, avocado, fat, and sugar, fruit juice, other simple sugars. Now, if you don't do that and you eat less, as you just mentioned, it's a diet without starch, a lot of green yellow vegetables, you don't get enough energy. And any population that tried to do that would not exist. If you were in a village and you decided you were going to adopt a diet of green and yellow vegetables, the next village over would come and rape your women and kill your men. You'd be done. You couldn't defend yourself. So again, it has to. The diet is a starch-based diet with fruits and vegetables. All right, yes?
Is the hunter and gatherer diet, it might be in a kind of a pretty average kind of area, say, within a maybe 500 miles of the equator or something. Hunter-gatherer diet, is it starch-based?
We're talking about the hunter-gatherers from 750,000 years ago up until 24,000 years ago. Are we talking about the hunter-gatherers who today live off the Amazon or in the deepest part of Africa?
Both, but the thing is, if agriculture came in 10,000 years ago,
about 24,000.
Did starch-based diets come in 10,000 years ago?
Correct, 24,000.
But people were healthy before that.
Well, the average lifespan was 20 to 25 years. I mean, they have not found any, as in my readings, they have not found any skeletons that were over 50 years of age. Now, I'm sure they didn't die of heart disease and things like that. They died of war and infection and problems like that.
We can't use that as a criteria because we live now longer than we did our ancestors 100 years ago.
We do, because we've solved problems of sanitation, immunization, and better nutrition. I mean, it better in terms of at least people have enough food to live on. I mean, those are the main differences that happened 100 years ago. And then in the last, the hunter-gatherer is a whole argument for people who want to prove that you need to eat meat in your diet. It's what happens is they take a point of view that justifies their gluttony.
Yeah, but you have grass beef versus grain beef. We have grain beef now, which is an unnatural product.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Well, let's just take a look at the Eskimo. I mean, this is a hunter-gatherer that we can study right now in real time. And they have been studied. The average lifespan of an Eskimo is 28 years, but some live longer. They have the highest incidence of osteoporosis of any population on the planet. And I don't believe you could survive in that environment on the McDougal diet.
Well, they also get way too little vitamin C.
I don't believe you could... You could survive on our diet in that kind of a demanding environment. So I think that if somebody said that you should eat from your environment, it'd be a wise thing to say. In those kinds of extremes.
Doctor, from the science standpoint, like you showed a couple extreme behaviors, drinking to excess and taking in a gas called smoking. Now, do you advocate making behavioral changes such as diet, using science to make sure that the body's not overreacting or underreacting, so that what's called the goal, I want to use the word status quo or balance. So a healthy body you call balance, so that the biochemistry is doing whatever nature's got, whoever. So the question is, in your practice, do you use the science to monitor the progress to make sure that body functions are not like you quit smoking or drinking, the heart rate changes, etc.?
Well, let me ask you in hopefully the ways that you're asking the question, okay? First of all, I think what he's asking is do I teach a diet as extreme as a diet that's pure vegetarian, low fat, people?
Not so much that it's extreme. The idea is not to advocate cold turkey.
Yeah, no, I advocate cold turkey. I take people, I lock them up for 10 days, I charge them a sensible amount of money, and I make them do this 100%.
Yeah, well, that's nice of you.
Yeah, and they love me for it, which is even nicer. All right, but let me answer your question, because I think a lot of things came out of that are really important. For example, you brought up Somebody brought up the failure of the low-fat diet from last week. I mean, this made national headlines. And of course, I got a lot of questions about these national headlines. This was the Women's Health Initiative. The primary founders of this study are people I know quite well. The Ernst Wender, who's dead. He's an older man, great guy. I mean, he was one of my heroes, Ernst Wender. And Rowan Chablowski, who appears on the paper as the second author on the paper that came out in JAMA last week. I had both of those gentlemen on my radio show several times, and I had Chablowski on my television show. And on each occasion, we talked about the diet that they recommended, which was a reasonable diet, a sensible diet, a moderate, a prudent diet. And I said, you know, you really don't want to do that because you've only got one shot at this, $415 million, 12 years you've got. You only have one shot at this, and you need to teach them the best possible diet to get the best possible results. And they reassured me on each occasion that we were together that a moderate diet was the way to go because you couldn't get anybody to eat a really, really, well, what they would call a strict diet, I'd call a sensible diet. Well, here we are 12 years later, $415 million in down paid for a study that shows a complete failure. And what were the results of the people? Well, the average woman in this woman's study weighed 176 pounds when they started. And when they ended, those on the low-fat diet group weighed 1 pound less after 8 years of dieting. They had the same cholesterol, same triglycerides, same blood pressures. They ate the same amount of protein, the same amount of fiber, similar amount of red meat, the same amount of chicken, the same amount of grain, the same amount of fish. They didn't change. So I can't teach, it might be your question, but I can't teach people moderation. People come to me with certain requests. Like, for example, they come to me and they say, "Doctor, I'm tired of coughing and I don't want to get lung cancer. How many cigarettes should I smoke?" Okay. People come to me and they say, "You know, I'm tired of being fat, and I'm tired of taking blood pressure pills and diabetic pills and, you know, all kinds of things." And they say, "How much of this garbage should I eat?" And I say, "None." So, and then maybe you're asking, and again, I'm putting words into your mouth, but it doesn't matter. You've opened a good set of questions. And then they, you know, the people say to me, "Well, it's so much harder to make these kind of strict changes." It's not, it's really easier. And the reason it's easier is this, because it's because of the dramatic results that you get, which I'm going to show you right now. You see, if you do something like Weight Watchers ask you to be sensible, reasonable, moderate. Not that I don't think it's a good program. I think there's some very, very positive things about this. But the average weight loss in 2 years of those who follow the diet is 6 pounds. Okay? If you take and look at the National Cholesterol Education Program with high cholesterols, the average drop in cholesterol in a year is 5%. Okay, so you learn to like new foods, socialize differently, shop differently. You know, you change everything and you get almost nothing. Or if you learn to shop differently, socialize differently, cook differently, like different foods, and you get the kind of results I'm going to show you now, it's much, much easier for somebody to do this. Big changes beget big results, and if you get big results, you're willing to do it. If you get hardly anything, like they did in the Women's Health Initiative, why bother? Okay, this is one typical example. And by the way, these are typical examples of people that I take care of. Just like if we talked about a few minutes ago, and I hope I have most of you agreeing with me, that the reason these people are sick is because they ate too much rich food. If you stop them from eating the rich food, they get better. And if you're not with me to that point, you'll probably consider the rest of this unreasonable too. But if you are, then you'll understand when I say that these are the results to be expected. It's extremely unusual, in my experience, not to get these kinds of results. And I'm going to show you with these patients. And we can talk about the reasons why, if you want, as we go along. This is a fellow from Australia. And he discovered he had type 2 diabetes. And he discovered that he had to be on medication. And he has a young, beautiful wife. And he decided that's not the way he wanted to live his life. He found our program and adopted the program in September 2004. At that time, he was 242 pounds, blood sugar 340. He was on glucophage, which is a diabetic pill at that time. High cholesterol, high triglycerides. And then by March 7th of 2005, this is what happened. He dropped to 185, glucose 189, cholesterol 182, and triglycerides 82. Simply through dietary change. No supplements, no pills. He's off all his medication. This lady right here.
What was the time period?
That was between September and March.
Half a year.
Half a year, yeah.
Did you measure the lean body mass and the amount of muscle that they had?
No.
Okay.
It could be of interest to somebody, but I think pictures show 1,000 words. There are lots of things. You can measure C-reactive protein. You measure him to death. But the fact is this man has regained a lot of health. But, okay, let's talk about this interesting couple. This lady, Glenn, she decided to change her diet because she was constipated. And she was a little bit arthritic. No big deal. Attractive, trim woman. And that was enough for her. She'd had it. She was no longer going to put up with these inconveniences. It was so serious, she was willing to do something drastic, like eat oatmeal. And she changed her diet, and I bring her out as an example because, you see, I discovered a long time ago, I can't predict who's going to do this. I see people with a little bit of bitty issues that may be a little bitty to you and I, like a little constipation, a little oily skin, a family history of heart disease, something that you would say, heck, I wouldn't change my diet for that. And they just do it. They change their diet. Then I see other people who have the knife pointed at their chest. They're going for bypass surgery next week, and they're not going to budge. So I don't know who's going to change. So I always try and present the same enthusiastic story to each and every person that I see. Because it's a personal decision as to whether you're going to change. Well, that was enough for her, so she changed. Well, her husband's an internist, and he has a practice in San Antonio, Texas. And she wanted to go on one of our McDougal adventures, and this one was to Alaska in 2002. And so she said, well, I want you to come along. He said, I will, because I'm going to show you what a quack this McDougal is. Okay. And he came along, fully armed to defend his wife, and by the end of the 7 days, his attitude was completely different. And he tries to practice the kind of medicine that he learned on that trip with his patients, and it's just economically too difficult. It takes time. It's not profitable to spend an hour talking to somebody. But he does try whenever he gets a chance. Anyways, Joe went to a cholesterol 222 down to 121 and lost 35 pounds in a very short period of time. This lady, Joyce Shank, 263. She'd been in the hospital several times for pneumonia and bronchitis. She had spinal stenosis, arthritis, or arthritic medications. She couldn't take severe ulcers. Anyway, she changed her diet, and she got written up in the newspaper. This is a picture from the newspaper. And she lost 132 pounds, dropped her cholesterol 100 points, and no medications. Our average drop in cholesterol, we've measured and published the results of our drops in cholesterol. Our average drop in cholesterol in 11 days is 29 points. That's measuring cholesterol in 1,500 people. If you start with high cholesterol like this lady, say you started at 263, the average drop in cholesterol is over 60 points in 11 days. Okay?
What was the 29 points?
That's for the whole group. Everybody, you know, starting high cholesterol is 150 all the way to 450. 11 days? Oh, I don't know. I'm sorry. I don't know what the time is. I got on some of them. Others, I. The average weight loss in people is about eight to 20 pounds a month when they follow the program. Depends on how overweight you start at, and depends on how strictly you follow the program, whether you add exercise to the program or not. This gentleman, he was the financial controller of the state of Wisconsin. And that's, of course, America's Dairyland. And he was consuming handfuls of Tums for his indigestion. He was on the obligatory antidepressant. He was on blood pressure pills, allergy pills. The problem was this, is he was 58 years old. And he was retiring as the chief financial officer of the state of Wisconsin. So he's a very successful guy. He'd worked hard. He'd gained a lot of wealth. You know, was a real top person in his field, very well respected. But the problem was is he couldn't walk up the stairs because the chest pain, it was so bad. So here he was, like a lot of people. They've worked all really hard their whole life to gather wealth, and now they're ready to retire, and they don't have their health. So, you know, he's a smart guy. He started looking around for various options. He said he went to the bookstore, and he saw all the different diet books. You know, there's protein diet books and, you know, everything you want. Body type, blood type, you name it. There's there. And he saw this book there with this friendly guy, a big smiley face and an apple in his hand. He thought, well, that's a good book to buy. So he picked up a book that I wrote about 15 years ago. And he changed his diet, and this is 7 months. And he lost 40 pounds. And again, I show you these, and we could go over the scientific research that supports all this stuff. It's consistent, it's clear, it's published in the best journals. But, you know, this is typical of what we see. Lost 40 pounds off all his medications. This has dropped cholesterol and triglycerides, blood pressure drop. And he's got his life back. And that's a very, very important thing to know. And, you know, we don't learn these kinds of things until later in life. I'd almost killed myself by the time I was 27 years old. You know, I had a major stroke. I had a cholesterol 335. I was 50 pounds heavier than I am now. You know, and I'd have been dead before 40. So, you know, you just learn these things later on, and it doesn't seem to matter how late in life you learn it. It's amazing how wonderful the body's ability to recover is once you stop abusing it with these rich foods, or tobacco, or alcohol, or whatever it happens to be. In other words, self-care. This is an interesting guy. This fellow, Mike Wilson. I used to have a practice in Hawaii, which is very interesting. It was interesting because if I had to live on my follow-up business, I would starve to death. People came to see me because I had my own radio show. I was on television quite often. I did a lot of media work. And they listened to the message and they'd say, well, that's interesting, but I bet he doesn't mean me. And they'd come and see me to find out whether it really applied to them or not. And so I would interview them, do my history, and then what I'd do is I'd tell them, I said, yeah, you've got to do this. Well, 90% of the people walked out of the office and never returned. I lost those patients. And then maybe 10% is an exaggeration, maybe 5% came back. And they listened to what I had to say. They changed their diet, and I'd take them off some medications the next week, and then they'd come back the next week, and I'd take them off more medication, and they'd come back the third week, I'd take them off all their medication. And the fourth week, the conversation was always the same. Okay, doc, I'm not sick anymore, I'm not on drugs anymore, why should I see you anymore? And I lost those patients. So, to see our patients, I used to see 9 to 12 new people a day. That's the only reason I survived. But follow-up business was terrible. So to see our patients, what we started doing is we started having potluck dinners all around Hawaii in condominiums and yacht clubs and various places. We'd get together every month with our patients and have these wonderful dinners and talks and speakers. We had all kinds of well-known speakers at that time come in and talk to these people. Well, this fellow right here was brought by one of his friends to one of our potluck dinners, and he liked what we had to say. He eventually did come to see me in the office. This was about 24 years ago. He had severe diabetes, arthritis, gout, sleep apnea, insomnia, back pain, neck pain, congestive heart failure. His heart had already stopped once, and he had chronic pain, and he was depressed, to say the least. And these are his pictures. He was on 25 prescriptions. Told me he felt guilty. My life was terrible, and you know, he'd complain about things, and we've talked about this over the years. I don't remember this from 24 years ago, but he would tell me these things in some of the conversations we've had recently. He'd say, you know, it really bothered me that I'd have to take in Hawaii now, buy these big cars to ride around in. Because he was so big, he couldn't fit in a regular sized car. In Hawaii, you know, it's a tough place to ride around big cars. Streets are small, the gas is expensive, and that bothered him a lot. And there were all kinds of other things that bothered him a lot. The thing that bothered him most was his kids. He couldn't play with his kids. And finally he decided, he says, I've had enough. I'm going to change the way I live and eat. So he did. Anyway, I'm not going to show you what happened for a minute. I got a call about 5 years ago when Donahue had his cable show. And his producers called me up and they said, we'd like to have some of your patients on the show. And we're going to have Robert Atkins' patients on the show too. They didn't want Robert Atkins and I on the show, but they wanted our patients on the show. So I sent Mike from Hawaii to New York, and I sent another person with a similar story. He'd only lost about 90 pounds. And I sent them to the show. If you turned the volume off and you watched the show, there'd be no question about the difference in the health of these people. Atkins' patients stood up. They're all women. They were all still fat, and they'd say things like, I lost 35, I lost 40 pounds, 45 pounds. And they all looked sick. And Mike stood up, and so did the other person, and they looked not only thin, but they looked fantastic. Fantastic. It's because they had regained their health. This isn't just a matter of weight loss. This is a matter of regaining your health. This is interesting, lady. Anybody go on VegSource? You go on VegSource. Okay, this is Sabrina and Jeff run VegSource. And their parents are actually from around the Bay Area. Mother-in-law, Jeff's mom, she'd been following our diet and recommended the book to Sabrina. Said, you know, you really ought to follow the McDougal program. This is maybe 12 years ago or so. Well, Sabrina was a vegetarian, and she saw no need to follow the McDougal program. She was already vegetarian. She was overweight, and she was young, so she felt she was pretty healthy. And she at that time had, twin girls and a little boy. And this is a woman, by the way, who really cares about her personal appearance. I mean, she just every hair is in place. She's so particular about her makeup, everything. I mean, this is just the kind of person she is. And then she got this burning sensation in her ears. And she went to the doctor, and the doctor says, well, you have relapsing polychondritis. And he said that what's going to happen is your ears are going to end up looking like this, and you're going to lose your nose, and you're going to lose your ribs, and that's what's going to happen. And there's no way we can stop it. So she dragged the McDougal book down, and she decided that she was going to get rid of the dairy and the oils and so on, and she's been free of disease for 8 years now. This is an interesting lady. This lady, Phyllis Hyphy is her name, she developed rheumatoid arthritis in 1996. Got progressively worse to the point where she couldn't walk across the room without being in tears because the balls of her feet hurt so bad. She went to the rheumatologist and asked for the solution to this problem. The solution was methotrexate, and she was told all the complications of methotrexate. She says, this is not what I want to do. So what she did is she went to the internet. She found our site, decided, what the heck, I got nothing to lose. So she tried the diet, which is, you know, no pills, no expense, no nothing, just eat potatoes and rice. And she followed the diet. She wrote me a letter. She said, I want you to know I cured my rheumatoid arthritis. I said, well, you know, that's interesting. There are 25 studies in the major medical journals that say you can cure your rheumatoid arthritis with this approach. The major medical journals, like The Lancet, Arthritis and Rheumatism, Annals of Internal Medicine, the major medical journals, 25 studies. You can find them on my website if you'd like to see them. If you go see your doctor and you ask about diet and arthritis, you'll likely be told there's no connection. You're wasting your time, or you're too stupid to follow a diet. Why did I even teach you one? All right, so anyway, she wrote me a letter. She says, tells me all this miraculous stuff, and I said, well, we've written a couple people up as star McDougalers who have cured the rheumatoid arthritis, and they always make good stories. Of course, this is an incurable disease. I said, I'd like to write you up a star McDougaler. And by the way, if you want to read any of these stories, they're all on my website. They're under a section called Star McDougalers. You can read all the details, and maybe the dates are there, more information. This is just some of the things that I remember. So I said, let's write your story up. She says, I can't. She said, I live in Toronto, and I run one of the biggest physician financial groups in the entire city. And she said, if anybody, any of the doctors I work with knew I did this, that she said, I might be fired. They might not, you know, they might get rid of our financial group, and I own the group, you know. I mean, she was a very important CEO of this huge company that takes care of all these doctors' businesses and finances. We decided on a compromise. We'd use her maiden name. She was good with that for about 2 days, and I told her we had to use her picture, and she said, no, I can't do that. I said, look, Phyllis, the object of being a star McDougaler is to make people feel good, is to help people. And I said, obviously, I'm making you very uncomfortable, so let's just forget it. So this was in about 2000, 2002, something around there. We had this conversation. I just let it go. Well, I got a letter from her, an email, in July of 2004. And she said, I want to tell my story. And the reason I want to tell my story is I just spent 2 weeks in Paris, going all over Paris, with my two girls and my husband, you know, doing everything. She says, right, I had to go back to my room and fix my own food. She said, but I'm completely free of disease, and I want other people to know this. Now, it's kind of interesting. We ran one of our 10-day programs. It was January last month, and Phyllis attended the 10-day program. Why? She's completely free of rheumatoid arthritis. She looks, I mean, she's 58 years old. She looks like she's 38 years old. Feels phenomenal, and I was kind of a little shocked. She decided to come to the program. She said, I want to come because I want to be amongst people who think and feel like I do. It's a really lonely world out there, she said. And she tells everybody now. She doesn't care. She doesn't really care about the financial issues. And she's surprised she hasn't gotten into any trouble or had any really... The usual response is, well, Phyllis, that works for you. Just keep doing it.
Doctor,
yes?
With respect to arthritis and sleep apnea, I understand arthritis tends to be a degenerating type of thing which attacks bone by hitting out and wearing away the bone.
Well, that's one kind of arthritis. That's osteoarthritis.
And then you lose the cartilage.
That's osteoarthritis. This is rheumatoid arthritis. This is inflammatory arthritis.
With respect to OA, how does this...
Well, I just have to tell you my impression. I would have to say about half the people are benefited, whereas when you deal with rheumatoid arthritis, I mean, the benefits are well over 70%, dramatic. And that's what the scientific literature says. That just isn't my experience. And by the way, we have published a study on this also from our group. Osteoarthritis, there's been some studies to show that the cartilages will heal. Yeah, they will heal. And there's never been any large study on what the effect of a diet would be. But everybody who has degenerative arthritis, particularly of your lower extremities, what's the first thing the doctor tells you to do?
Replacement.
Lose weight. Not replacement, but good try. All right, let's talk about this lady. This is Deb Tesak, and she came to our July program. This is her in July of 1988. And July of 1991, she became very dizzy. In fact, so dizzy that she couldn't even get out of bed for a month to go see the doctor. That's how sick she was. She didn't have the money to get, you know, an ambulance, the whole thing. So she just laid around and threw up for a month. Well, finally, after a month, she was able to go to her family doctor. The family doctor said, look, this is something really serious, this vertigo you have and nausea and so on. And you've got to go see a neurologist. So the neurologist saw her, and the neurologist said to her, Deb, you have multiple sclerosis. And he turned around to the blackboard and he says, here's where you are right now as far as your function. Here's where you're going to be in 5 years in a wheelchair. And here's where you're going to be in 10, bedridden or dead. Okay, that was his bedside manner. Well, you know, needless to say, that's not what she would wanted to look forward to. And so she started looking into dietary change. And she changed. She became a semi-vegetarian in 2000. Found our program in 2001, and this is her when she came to our program in July of 2005. And this is what you see on a brain scan, an MRI, with multiple sclerosis. The white areas are the lesions you get from the body attacking the brain. And this, of course, is a more progressive MRI that you see. And the disease with MS is progressive. And let me tell you what the data says. And this is very upsetting, I know, and nobody likes to hear it. But the truth is that within 10 years of diagnosis, half of the people with multiple sclerosis are unable to walk unassisted, wheelchair-bound, bedridden, or dead with the best medical therapy available. Because these things progress in almost all cases. So anyway, Deb's MRI says this. The last line says this is the one she got in 2002. She's gotten them since. They have similar reports. Compared to March of 2000, the multiple lesions in the brain described above are slightly smaller and do not show any interval increase in size. Now, that didn't surprise me, but it may surprise you. If you are familiar with multiple sclerosis and diet, then you know this man. There are so many, in fact, I had several other of my heroes in this presentation I was going to talk about. There's so many people who are my heroes, like Walter Kempner and Russell Henry Chittenden and Nathan Pritikin. All kinds of pioneers that have gone many years before me made the same kind of discoveries, developed very similar programs, and these are people whose shoulders I stand on. The things I tell you about are not original. You know, they're based on many, many other people's observations, scientists' observations. In fact, they go back, as far as I know, one of the earliest references to what I do is very simply stated in the first chapter of Daniel in the Bible. Daniel's men were sick because they were eating the king's food. Daniel says to the gatekeeper, let's put them on vegetables and water and see what happens. And in 10 days, they were healthier looking than the men who ate the royal food. Right, it was not a double-blind, placebo-controlled experiment. But it's been in the book for 2,600 years. It wasn't true that it had thrown it out. It would have been a bad story. So anyway, these kinds of things that I'm sharing with you are not new. I don't take any claim to originality. There are many, many other people who have the same. Let me finish the story about Swank, and I'll go on and answer your question. Anyways, Roy Swank, he's 95 years old now, and he's been a friend of mine for over 25 years. He has published over 176 papers in the best medical journals. Roy Swank has studied multiple sclerosis for 50 years. He was the head of neurology at the University of Oregon Medical School for 23 years. He developed the low-fat dietary treatment for MS. He's treated over 5,000 people, and the results are, if you follow a low-fat diet, that you have less than a 5% chance of getting worse over the next 35 years. As I told you, with the best drug therapy available within 10 years, half the people are disabled or dead. 5,000 people, 50 years of research, published in the best medical journals, and completely ignored. Okay? And a man of impeccable credentials. But there are all kinds of people like this. Yes, you had a question. Probably.
I understand there's a whole issue of getting being able to eat just a little bit, but if you're just going to design the healthiest diet, doesn't that avoid some of the potentially long-term issues like iodine and B12 that this year is doing?
Well, the iodine is never a problem from lack of meat. Now, iodine may be a problem from where your vegetables are growing, but they're not a problem from lack of meat. Iodine is a mineral that comes from the soil. B12 is an issue we can talk about later. But the main reason that I make the recommendations I do is because people have a very difficult time of seeing gray and yellow. They do red and green or black and white really well, but they don't do gray well. This is some of the problems that I've seen with other people who have been before me, like Nathan Pritikin, for example, who's a very good friend of mine. And I don't say anything, this conversation should be interpreted as only respect for what he did. But we used to discuss this, argue about this, whether or not the little bit, the 2 ounces of chicken, fish, and beef that he added in his diet was okay for people. And the answer is probably okay from a physical point of view, but from a mental point of view, there's some real serious problems that happen. That is, 2 ounces starts out this big the first week, and the next week it's this big, and the next week it's half a chicken. Have you ever been a cigarette smoker? You ever known a cigarette smoker? Anybody ever see a cigarette smoker cut down and quit? I never have. If you've ever been an addict of anything, alcohol, tobacco, or alcohol, tobacco, coffee, illicit drugs, the only way you stopped is you made a decision, and that decision was to stop, period, cold turkey. You don't cut down as an addict and quit. It just doesn't happen. Now, it's the same thing with food, I find, and that is it's much easier to make clean breaks in things. In other words, today I eat garbage and tomorrow I eat good food, period. Not, I'm going to have a little bit of garbage today, it's okay, I'll give myself permission, because it's so easy to escalate back to where you were before.
But if you're not an addict, you just need to eat because
you're going to feel good. Again, you come to me and you ask me, doctor, I don't want to get lung cancer, how many cigarettes should I smoke? If I told you to, you'd probably do fine. But very few people can do that. And besides that, what kind of a doctor would you think I was if I told you that? The body is tough. The body puts up with a good dose of arsenic. It survives. Hey, I've tested my body. My body, and I'm not joking, my body put up with 2 packs of cigarettes, a half a bottle of whiskey a day, and grease, and it lived for many years. Okay? The body's a miracle in what it can put up with. But that's not the kind of question that I ask myself anymore. What I ask myself now about myself is how well can I take care of myself? How much good health can I eke out of this body? It's only got so many years left. You know, I'm almost 60 years old. I've got, 30 maybe if I'm lucky. I know if I take the right supplement, I'll get 110. But I really believe that maybe I've got, I'm 90 if I'm lucky, maybe if I'm extremely lucky, 100. So I want to get as much out of it as I can. Now, I'll tell you something else about me that I just want to share on a personal level, is I am not a moderate person. My wife is a moderate person. She can have a little bit of wine, a small cup of diluted coffee. I don't. I give myself permission. I do it with enthusiasm. And my patients are the same way. I don't see moderate people in my practice. I see those that go for life with gusto. And what they've done is they've destroyed their health as a consequence. So, in answer to your question, sure. But, that's great. If you can live moderately, you'll probably live a good, healthy life. I don't take care of those kind of people. Yes?
I became a complete vegetarian, no eggs, no cheese, very low fat, in 1979. In 93, I was diagnosed with MS. I started adding fish track to my diet. I improve.
Good. Well, Dr. Swank would recommend, do you know Dr. Swank?
I've heard of him.
Yeah. He would recommend some fish type oils for your diet.
Yeah. The anti-inflammatory omega-3.
But if you read his research, you would know that the main issue is saturated fat.
Yeah, but I didn't use it.
Well. It is in blood types and all these. I don't believe that. Okay. I mean, I believe there's some slight variation. Okay, but I don't believe that it's a huge variation. It's just like when you, I've got three kinds of animals at home that I love dearly. I've got these two wonderful cats. I've got these three beautiful parrots. And I've got this dog that, dog. I mean, he's just my best friend. I never feed my dog nuts on purpose. He eats them, though, but that's not his diet. I don't. And I never give my parrots dog food. My cats never get peanuts. You know, there's a specific diet for each of these animals, and if you happen to work in a zoo, I bet you find a specific diet for each and every animal. And they live on simple diets, like, for example, the koala bear lives on what? Bamboo shoots, right? Or eucalyptus trees. And that's their whole diet. I mean, there's seven species of eucalyptus trees, and that's every koala bear lives on that. Not some of them eat cat food, and some of them eat walnuts. All of them live on that. And the same thing with panda bears. They all live on bamboo shoots. And I mean, why is it that every other species of animal has a particular diet that it thrives on, and human beings have different body types and blood types? And this, I don't believe it. I honestly don't believe it. It's not been my experience. I hear what you're saying, but it's not been my experience. What I would do, if you saw me personally and you really had some issues that you'd like to work out, there may be some starches you don't do well with. I mean, a lot of people don't do well with wheat. You know, I mean, they do terrible with any gluten products. A lot of people have trouble with beans.
But there's starch in
beans
and lentils and starches in green vegetables.
Well, there are starches in all your vegetable foods, only your vegetable foods. So, I mean, there may be some intolerances you have. Some people don't do well on corn. Mm-hmm. And so you have to limit your diet, and there's something called an elimination diet that I use to help people work through it. But I still believe that you don't defy what I see in human beings, that a starch-based diet would be best for you. Yes?
First of all, I don't know you. I've never heard your name or your diet or anything, but I just want to tell everyone here that I support 100% what you say about cold turkey. I went to see a doctor. I have chemical sensitivity and fibromyalgia at 5 feet. And I had fibromyalgia so bad that I couldn't hardly get out of the chair.
That's about how long it takes. And you know, they called yours fibromyalgia. You've seen another doctor, he might have said you had rheumatoid arthritis. Somebody else could have told you had lupus. It really doesn't make any difference. You had inflammatory arthritis, arthralgias. It doesn't make any difference. The names are irrelevant. And you get the similar response. We take care of lots of people with fibromyalgia, and there are two scientific papers published on using our kind of diet and curing fibromyalgia. And you'll find those on the website. Okay, let's move along here a little bit. You know, these are just people I randomly threw in just to give you an idea of the broad spectrum of problems that are taken care of. There's also a whole bunch of hormone-related problems that people have. Breast cancer, fibrocystic breast disease, PMS, ovarian cysts, uterine cancer, various hormone-related diseases in women. In men, there are problems like male pattern baldness. There's prostate enlargement, prostate cancer. These are sex hormone-related diseases. This lady had a sex hormone-related disease called endometriosis. She was very sick. And she was so sick, I mean, her whole life was incapacitated, particularly around menstrual period of time. And she was also infertile. And it got to the point where her and her husband wanted to have a baby, and it was $10,000 a try. And she couldn't afford to do that, so she just gave up on the idea of having a baby. And she started our program in 91, and the results are evident. And you say, this is bizarre. Why would this kind of thing ever happen? Well, the effect of diet is absolutely profound in terms of changing her whole hormone makeup. She got over her endometriosis, and she changed enough of her hormone makeup that even though she tried almost everything else, she did not have a baby. Maybe it was a coincidence, but she doesn't think so. This is the last person that we wrote up. And again, you'll find those on my website under Star McDougallers. This guy, I have to drag these people sometimes to tell their story. I really do. They want to tell their story because they want to help other people. Of course, it's kind of embarrassing to put yourself out there in front of the world because our website is read by, you know, thousands of people. And we have a free newsletter, by the way, and all these things go to people, these stories. And so it's kind of hard to get people to come out sometimes. Anyway, I met them last September for the first time. And they told their story to me. And I said, look, you ought to write it up. Let's tell them as a Star McDougaller and send it out. This is Ralph, 300 pounds. Ralph and his wife, 300 pounds. And he had atrial fibrillation, was defibrillated 6 times, went back into atrial fibrillation, was put on various drugs. The next thing was where they take and they go and they actually cut some of the fibers in the heart. And he didn't want to go through that kind of heart surgery. And so he decided that it was bad enough, so he's willing to change his diet. And this is, of course, a real turning point in a lot of people's lives is they have to get to the point where the inconvenience of being sick and ugly outweighs the inconvenience of taking care of themselves. And you never know where that point comes. And generally, the people who really do change their diets are people who have been working on it for a long time and failing. When we start a new program every month, they come in and people say, you know, I really shouldn't be here. I've tried this diet. It just didn't work for me. I mean, it's not that it didn't work. I mean, I lost weight. It's the best I ever felt, but I just couldn't stick to it. And my response to them is, you know, this is where you ought to be. You're going to succeed. We're going to put it all together for you. The fact that you've been working on this for 5, 10, sometimes 15 years is the reason you're going to succeed. You don't make these kind of changes usually overnight, and then we get people who are dragged there by well-meaning friends and relatives, kicking and screaming. And they go through our 10-day program, and they're so excited at the end of the program. Oh, you know, I got off all my diabetic pills, all my blood pressure pills, my arthritis is gone, my bowels are finally moving. You know, everything is wonderful, and they feel so excited. I usually sit them aside, and I say, you know, I realize how excited you are, but you really haven't paid your dues. And there's a whole world out there that wants you to eat different. And they've got all kinds of tempting things to drag you back into your old ways. So what I would encourage you to do is go out with your great enthusiasm. Hopefully you will succeed. But if you don't, just remember that it takes time to make changes and keep us in mind. And so when you get ready to start it again, we'll be here to help you. Anyway, Ralph had been working on it. He and his wife worked for Loma Linda University in the medical school. And they tried everything. They were even on the liquid protein diets. But they finally decided to change their diet. Then 10 months, he lost 80 pounds. She lost 60. She got back into tennis. She was a professional tennis player. That was what she was most excited about. That's her picture in September of this year. I kind of saved the weight loss thing to last because I really hate to be thought of as a weight loss doctor. But that's one of the big reasons people come to see me. Isn't that sad? You know, I'm an internist. I like to take care of really sick people. This weight loss stuff is hardly any fun at all. This is a lady who came to our program in January, and in 2.5 months she lost, 30 pounds. 4 months she lost 43. See, about for a woman following the diet, 10 pounds, maybe 12 pounds a month, that's pretty average. But I mean, a year, that's 120 pounds. But what I want you to notice is the difference. This is not just a thinner woman, this is a younger woman, and also a more attractive woman. You know, when I was a young man, a teenager even, I remember this happening to me several times, is my dad and I'd be walking along and I'd look at this girl and I'd say, look at that, Dad. He'd say, son, what you're looking at is a healthy girl. That's what you like. I said, no, Dad, that's not what I'm looking at. He'd say, yes, you are. You don't realize it, but the reason you're attracted to that girl is because she's healthy looking. And I didn't really understand what he was saying. I do now at my age. That's what I was attracted to. This was a healthy-looking person. And it makes sense, isn't it, that you'd be attracted to healthy-looking people. And the beauty that came out of this person I was looking at was good health that I could see. And I see it in our people all the time. It's not that they just get thin, like I showed you this other, you know, the person that appeared on the Donahue show. These people look younger and more alive and healthier. This is a lady, again, this it demonstrates what I call, you know, continuing to try. She came to us in June of 2003. She came back in April of 2004. She came back in August of 2005. You know, that's, you know, 70 pounds later. And the nice thing, I mean, she'd been working on this for 8-10 years.
And
the diet that we teach?
That's what, I mean, like, so these are great pictures of people, but I haven't seen statistics, I haven't seen mechanisms, and I don't even know what the diet is yet, so I'd like to see that.
The diet is a diet based on starch with fruits and vegetables. Uh-huh. Okay. If you want to see the statistics, uh-huh. Would you like to see the statistics?
Am I seeing them here?
There's some in there, but I've written 10 best-selling books that have, you know, sometimes as many as 70 and 100 pages of scientific references.
Okay. Do you have any in this presentation?
No, I don't have any in the presentation. But I have the research to back all this up, and when I, you know, I gave you the introduction to this presentation, is that's what I told you I was going to tell you, is, you know, my experiences in this thing. But I know some of you would be offended because a lot of you like to see facts and statistics, and I watch the drug representatives come in and give the doctors facts, and they're so impressed. They're just so excited because they've got a citation down at the bottom that, by the way, the drug company paid for. And maybe hired a ghostwriter to sign on to it. So I'm sorry. One of the reasons I stayed at St. Helena Hospital for 16 years is because it was respectable. Honestly, I'm ashamed to tell you this, but one of the reasons I was there is because this was a respectable hospital. I was a doctor who pushed health food, which at best is quackery. So I figured being there, at least some of that respect would rub off on me. After 16 years, honest to God, I said, I'm not that kind of doctor. I don't care. I really don't need this. And it's the same thing with what you're asking, is I really don't need to do that. But it's there for you, if you want. Okay? I don't need to present facts and figures in terms of scientific, when I give a presentation. Yeah, and people with rheumatoid arthritis and so on. It's just a general story. If you want to read the facts and figures, they're all there for you. Okay, I mean, that's, and again, the preface as to what I was going to do for presentation, that's what I told you I was going to do. But I understand how you feel, and I know there are some of you people that feel the same way. You are dazzled by facts and figures, and I don't blame you. I used to be too, and hey, they've got to be there. It's important that they're there.
How about just what the diet is? Yeah,
let's talk a little bit about what the diet is. What do
you... Wait till I'm finished. Okay. You want to know everything right now, don't you? You're so excited, I bet you can hardly wait to do it. Okay, let me just finish the presentation, okay? It's getting late. And then I'll tell you what you want to know. We've also had a chance to take care of a lot of athletes. This is a lady named Mary All who had terrible asthma, and she wanted to be a runner. So she started following our program about 12 years ago. She comes in between 2 and 7 in the triathlons worldwide now. And she sometimes wears t-shirts, McDougal t-shirts and McDougal hats. This is an interesting lady. She came to my office 22 years ago. And she had a terrible story. She was a marathon runner, had been for 12 years, and she'd just gotten a divorce out of a terrible relationship. She was ready to really enjoy life, to really start living again. And she came to my office with this terrible story. She had breast cancer with invasion to the lungs. And she said, well, what can I do? I said, this is a pretty serious problem. I don't know what you can do, but I have been reading a lot of research on the relationship between diet and breast cancer. And there's some evidence that eating a healthy diet will actually change the course of this disease. And I showed her to my office, and I said, sit down here and read. And she read for a couple of days. She got up and said, I'm going to change my diet. That is clearly an anecdotal statement that cannot be supported by scientific evidence. But this is her. She is won this year her 1,000th gold medal in the triathlons.
What is Carter praised up there?
This is from a presentation I gave on people who have, who are afraid of carbohydrates, carbohydrate hysteria.
Wasn't the serotonin deficiency caused by carbs, right?
Pardon me?
Wasn't the serotonin deficiency caused by excess carbs? No?
Why would that be?
Carb craze? I think that was very serious. Right?
Okay. This was from a presentation that I gave about high carbohydrate diets. This is, let me just finish.
Your enthusiasm is based on your successful patients. You have thousands of them that you've cured.
Okay, go ahead.
How many things? I'm familiar with you, but these people aren't. They aren't familiar with how many.
Well, I have practiced this way since 1978.
So you have thousands of people.
I do. But, you know, his point is very important. I mean, the scientific research has to be there. It has to be stated.
But you already have that.
But, no, I have that. But I think more importantly is the first statement that I gave you, is that this is easy for you. You can all go down to SFO, I mean, tonight. And you can watch the airplanes come in with people from Thailand or China or Japan. I mean, it's changing fast. You better get down there tonight. Because McDonald's is running these countries over, and you can see exactly what I'm talking about. So we can talk about this what I believe from many points of view. And you know, which one is more important, more valued? My experiences, which you put some value in, and certainly I do, but it's an experience of one. Just like this woman right here who had trouble with carbohydrates, an experience of one. How about an experience of 1.75 billion people who live on starch-based diets today? And they move here to this country. And they don't just come from China, they come from Mexico. And we have an excellent example here of Mexicans, Hispanics. I mean, when I see, we go to this wonderful Mexican restaurant, and the guy who owns the restaurant is a huge success. He now has 6 Mexican restaurants. He's one of the most most successful entrepreneurs I've ever seen. And I sat down with him one day, and I said, Emiliano, I said, what'd you eat when you grew up? He says, corn tortillas and limes. He says, my dad was poor. We had 10 boys in the family. I said, come on, Emiliano, what'd you eat? Corn tortillas and limes. I said, how about beans? He says, sometimes. Now, Emiliano, he's starting to gain weight now, but he's muscular, good size, perfect teeth, and so are his 10 brothers, and I know 7 of them. And you know people like this too. And then what happens when the people from Mexico or Central America or other places where they lived on corn tortillas and limes and a few beans, what happens when they move to the United States and get all this good food? They have the highest rates of diabetes in the country. So, I mean, I think those are really more important things to look at. There's not a doctor that I know of who would tell you that type 2 diabetes is due to anything else but the rich Western diet or obesity. So how do you cure these things? You throw a bunch of drugs at them, or do you put them back in central Mexico? At least as far as the diet goes.
Is one component of the Western diet that's the problem, not the entire Western diet?
The entire Western diet. The entire Western diet. It's the sugar and the fat and the refining and environmental contaminants and all kinds of. In fact, it's so complex that I couldn't tell you what part of it does it most. Okay? I mean, it is so complex. Just like the food, and I know many of you are supplement enthusiasts. When you tell me that what vitamin C is good, I know it's good. But I know it's good in its original package. And I know it's good in the original package for one important reason. That package has been developed over the last 400 million years, or by divine creation. But it is right. It is right. And I don't know all the complexities of why it works. Okay? And so that's why I prescribe whole foods, because you know the history of them is so valid. Let me just finish this. Okay, this is one of our patients too. This is one of the few people we've taken care of, some fairly successful people in life. This is one of the few people who continues to give credit to what Mary and I did for him. In 1990, we put him on our program. He was overweight. He says he was overweight, and he couldn't run and still lose weight, because every time he went on a diet, he would lose his performing edge. And so I met him on a television show in Minneapolis back in 1990, and I said, Carl, do this. Well, Carl did it, and Carl will scream from the rooftops that he's a pure low-fat vegetarian, has followed our program since then, set the world record for the 100-meter dash, won 3 gold medals, still holds the record for the longest long jumps, 3 longest long jumps that's ever been done. And he attributes his best performance to following our program. Let's see. Okay, let me just regress a little bit. I have to tell you that our program does not work, and I'll tell you what the program is in a minute, without this. We do have a special pill that we have for sale. You brought them tonight, Mary? Okay. And these pills that we sell have M's on them, and the M stands for McDougal or money, depending upon the night. And I want to tell you about these pills because you're a really, you know, inquisitive group, and I did want to share with you what these pills are made of. They're the $245 each pill, the ones we charge $245 a piece for. You do have to take 2 a day until our mortgage is paid off. These pills contain a half a gram of dried powdered banana, 2 flakes of Quaker oats, 1 broccoli flowerette, 1/4 of a kidney bean, 1/2 of a small dried potato eye. Now I know some of you have an attitude that this, you want to take the really high quality stuff, you know. You can always tell when it's really high quality by the price, right? So we have a special pill that we sell. It's the super formula, and they're $12.95 each, so you know they're really good. And we make those by adding 3 sesame seeds each. And Mary has those for sale. But they only work if you follow the diet that I'm going to share with you along with the exercise program. Otherwise, they don't work. All right, let me just answer your question. And the diet that Mary and I have followed for 28 years and that we teach our patients is a diet that has traditionally been followed by people throughout most of human history, and as I told you, 60% of the people today. It's a diet based on starches like rice, corn, potatoes, sweet potatoes, beans, peas, lentils, with the addition of fruits and vegetables. Now, some of you ask about meat and other rich foods, and the way I talk about those is that these are intended for special occasions. In other words, birthday cake is for birthdays, and turkey is for Thanksgiving if you choose, and ham is for Christmas, and eggs are for Easter. But when I was growing up in the Midwest, every morning we started out with Easter. And every lunch and dinner we had Thanksgiving and Christmas, and every night after dinner we had a birthday party. Okay, that was the problem. And it's not that Mary and I don't have occasions of celebration, nor should you avoid these occasions. But you shouldn't be taught to celebrate. You know how to do that well enough on your own. So what we try and teach is something very, very specific. Is this? These are the foods that best supports health. Easter eggs will make you sick if you eat too many of them. Not if you just eat them on Easter. Of course, some of my patients are so sick at Easter time that they really shouldn't even do it then. But these things are for special occasion. They're, you know, candies for Valentine's Day, right? You got candy for Valentine's Day? And Halloween, it's not for every day of the week. So what does it translate into regular everyday people food? Mary has published over 2,500 recipes. There are probably 200 free and available on our website. The foods that we eat are very simple in our home. We eat about 6 or 8 different things. She's published 2,500 recipes. I've had to try them all. That's a difficult time in our life when we have to try Mary's new recipes. Not because they're not good, but they're not our favorites. You get to like just a few things. Right now, if I went around and asked you what you eat, each of you would tell me that you ate the same thing for breakfast, pretty much. Like every day we eat oatmeal for breakfast, that's what we have. If I ask you what you have for lunch, you'd probably tell me the same thing or a couple different things. For dinner, you'd go through 2 or 3 different things. I'd ask you about the restaurants you go to. Every time you go to that same Thai restaurant, you order the same thing off that menu. That Mexican restaurant, you order the same thing off that menu. You are monotonous. People are very monotonous in their eating. They eat 5, 6, 8 different things. She has 2,500 recipes published. Out of those, you've got to be able to find 5, 6, 8 different things. We, in our particular home, we like oatmeal for breakfast. We have for lunch usually leftovers, which means what do we have for dinner? Well, we have bean burritos. Mary makes a vegetable soup with bread. Sometimes she'll have a, what do you make, Mary? What have you made lately? All right. Anyways, they're very, very few things that we have that are our favorites. Most of the dishes, you want, what would you like me to be more specific? You ask about the diet?
That helps explain it pretty much.
Okay.
Well,
you can't make zero fat. Nature is very kind.
You know, close to zero fat, is that a goal?
No, you can't do that. The body does require fat.
Yeah, I'm just wondering how much of what type.
Well, I didn't design it, but what's in the food is about 7% fat. And of that fat, half of it's essential fat. It happens to translate into about 12% protein, but 7 to 15% protein. Carbohydrate content's about 7 to 85%. That's good stuff, but I don't think phytic acid inhibits protein. Phytic acid inhibits minerals, but I don't believe it inhibits protein, and I'd like you to show me where it does. But phytic acid does inhibit minerals like zinc absorption, but the phytic acid in plants also has some very positive effects, like it has very strong anti-cancer effects that you're probably aware of, right? our creator or the 400 million years of evolution did not make a mistake in putting phytic acid in the food. Would you agree?
You know, I can also put you don't know. Widows out there. I don't eat those, so I can't say everything
is healthy. Well, you know, you bring that point up. You bring that point up. You know, I'm always in awe of nature. I'm sure those black widows are there for a reason.
Yeah, I'm just not eating.
Well, of course not. Yes?
What do you do with kids?
You breastfeed a child for 6 months exclusively, from 6 months to 2 years. They're partially breastfed, and the other part of the diet is starches, vegetables, fruits. After 2 years of age, you put them on, well, you can still nurse them for more if you want, but at that age, their intestinal tract is mature, their teeth are fully developed to eat food that is starch-based. Mm-hmm. Yes?
I believe that most of the people in Asia these days are obese, not because of McDonald's, because of the economic situation. They're much better off. I had dinner in Beijing a few months ago, and it was a very sumptuous dinner. And I kept asking the waiter for bai fan, which is their Chinese rice. And I kept yelling, and he kept ignoring me. Finally, I said to one of the people at the table, when do we get rice?
Yeah.
And they said, oh, at the end of the meal, if you're still hungry, you get a little rice.
Right, everybody wants to be like an American. You know, I agree with you. I just gave McDonald's an example. It's all the westernization of the Eastern diet. It's not just McDonald's. They all want to be like Americans. So they're all becoming like Americans. You want to make money? Invest in a drug company or a device, medical device company that's going to sell these things to Asians or Hispanics or, you know, in South America or Central America. You make tons of money because these diseases, they'll be just as sick as we are. Well, they almost are. Yes?
When you age, do you need things like taking some cod liver oil and taking some supplements because you're not really...
I know you do.
I buy into that.
I didn't want to get into that. I wanted to retain whatever popularity I had by this point. Yes.
Buy into it because of age.
I don't buy into it. I don't believe it. I don't believe it. You know, I really seriously didn't want to get into this. Yes.
I was wondering if you could talk about Barry Sears and his own diet.
Yeah, I actually debated Barry Sears on three occasions, and it's on my website. And also on that set of DVDs is a whole discussion of that debate and also discussions about some of the dealings I had with Robert Atkins. So, I mean, I think if you're really interested, just go to the website, you read something called The Great Debate, and it goes over all that, or listen to the set of DVDs where I discuss it. Yes?
I was curious, the woman who came to you with breast cancer, was she
She's 24 years now, still alive and fully functional with no evidence of disease. But you know, as most of the things I showed you in terms of the rheumatoid arthritis, the multiple sclerosis, and so on, solid scientific evidence behind this. I couldn't give you that kind of scientific evidence behind the breast cancer. Yet, that same study that was just published by Chabowski, they showed a 9% reduction in the risk of getting breast cancer with the almost non-existent one increase in fruit and vegetable consumption a day. Plus, Chabowski's work, which has recently been discussed in the scientific conferences, shows that women who have breast cancer live longer when they follow our diet. I also, just incidentally, I published the first study on the dietary treatment of breast cancer back in 1982. So I do believe it's true. It's just the evidence is meager. There are about 15 studies that say you can change the course of breast cancer with feeding the kind of diet we recommend. Yes? Yes.
And,
how about Atkins? Yeah, I think there's some truth to that. I had this very same conversation on one of my radio shows about 12 years ago with Robert Atkins. He was my guest on the show. And I had him on twice. I had a syndicated radio show all over the West Coast. And he mentioned, he said at the end of the show, he says, you know, it's kind of interesting that you and I get the same kind of results. And I said, yeah, it seems like we do. And for the reasons you just said, you take away a lot of junk from people. Plus, if you put people on a high-protein diet, they lose weight for reasons that they may not be necessarily healthy. Like, for example, you just mentioned breast cancer. A very effective way to lower cholesterol, reduce blood pressure, and lose weight is to go on chemotherapy. So, you know, I mean, just getting those results doesn't mean it was good for you. All right, so we got to the end of the conversation. I said, but there are two things we can agree on, Arthur Robert Atkins. One is all your patients are constipated. He said, yes. And two, every health organization presently in existence condemns what you do. He says, you're right. It's kind of interesting. After Atkins died, his medical reports came out, and I was asked to be on some shows like Deborah Norville and Neil Cavuto and CBS Morning and Evening News, and I was in the New York Times and so on. And I talked about Robert Atkins, the fact that he was obese and had horrible heart disease, which I think should count. I mean, if you look at somebody who's proponing a diet and they look like garbage, what do you think? Yeah. And I pointed this out. Well, I just want you to know, I've been in the practice of medicine. I've been licensed as a doctor since 1972. I have never had a single complaint, a letter written, a derogatory letter written about me that I'm aware of, or a lawsuit, which is, you know, just by good luck in those 32 years, except for one. And that was from Veronica Atkins. She turned me into the State of Hawaii Medical Licensing Board for violating her husband's privacy because I went on all these TV shows. And I was called by her a vegetarian Nazi for doing it. And currently she has a, as far as I know, an active pursuit to tarnish my medical license in Hawaii. Every time I talked to him, I said, let's go. Let's make it public. Let's do it. I want to. And so far it's been a year and a half and they have done nothing, so I don't know what's going to happen. I deal with these people all the time. I deal with them on a national level. I deal with them on talk shows, debates. I've debated them in front of the USDA. I deal with them all the time. But, you know, even though you lose weight, these are not healthy diets. You ought to be asking, let me just kind of end this because I know it's getting late. Most of you have had a chance. You've had a chance to ask a few questions. And I got to drive all the way back to Santa Rosa. Let me just tell you something. As I tried to share with you in the best manner I can, and hopefully you found it information that at least stimulated you to learn more. Doesn't have to convince you, but stimulated you to learn more. One of the things that I'd like to leave you with is this. Is just like with my parrot, I know what the right diet is for that bird. I really do. And like my cat, I know exactly what to feed my kitties. And likewise my dog. I know what allows them to best have the best health. I don't ask him if they like that or not. Okay? I love those animals. You should be asking the same thing. Whether I gave you the answer or not, irrelevant. You should be asking the same thing. What is the best diet? There has to be one. There has to be a best diet for people. We are not human garbage cans and can eat all the way from cat food to bird food and have it make no difference. It couldn't possibly be. There has to be an ideal diet for people, and you're feeding that diet to your kids and your spouses and your parents and yourself. You should know what the ideal diet is for people, and you don't. You don't. Because I could go through this group and I could ask you, and this is a more homogeneous group than I ever have a chance to talk to, I could ask you what the right diet is and you would all give me a different answer. Pretty close. Maybe a little bit of agreement. Most different answers. Why is that? That seems like a terrible, terrible gap in information that we ought to have. Basic information that should be taught in every school. That everybody should be, what is the right diet for people? You ought to be asking that question. Some of you ask how I came to the conclusions that I came to is, back 30 years ago when I was researching this and I spent my, you know, probably 6 years before I came to this conclusion, I asked that question. Based on the scientific research, is what is the best diet? I don't care if they like it or not. I don't really care. I just want them to get well. And I ended up as close as I could to the Kempner diet, which was taught at Duke University, still is at Duke University. The most popular thing at Duke University, the rice diet. You know about the rice diet? Okay, it's very just essentially our diet. It just tastes worse. And I came home and I said to Mary, I said, you know, the Kempner diet, all the things I'm telling you about, Kempner published in the journals before 1952. The diabetic retinopathy reversal, the diabetes reversal, the hypertension reversal, the cardiomyopathy reversal, the EKG reversals, the reversal of kidneys, all published in the scientific journals before 1952, using a starch-based diet with fruits and vegetables. And I came home and I said, you know, look at this. She says, we're going to have to eat this? I can do better than that. And so, you know, sometimes people ask me, well, what's the difference between what you do and what Ornish does, or Pritikin, or Walter Kempner, or Russell Henry Chittenden, or Roy Swank? There's a difference right there. What I know and what I teach is basically the same as what they know and they teach. I have no advantage over any of them. But I've got Mary. And Mary makes it practical and possible. If you had the opportunity to come to our clinic, this is the truth. You had the opportunity to come to our clinic and you stayed for one meal, and certainly if you stayed for 10 days, you'd understand the value. And it's easy to get people well on this kind of diet. What's difficult is to make them enjoy it more than they've enjoyed the food they've ever liked before. And she's done that. And you can see it in her recipe books. Anyway, it's much later than I ever planned to keep you. Thank you very much.
It's a privilege. Do you have a PPO that covers any medical coverage that covers your 10?
5 minutes of questions, and we'll have a 5-minute break.
Okay. Thank you. As Phil said, my name's Denise Johnson Kula. I'm the president of Citizens Concerned About Chloramine. And chloramine is a water disinfectant that is now in the Hetch Hetchy water as of February 2nd, 2004. And Lillian is going to pass out a little flyer so that you can follow along, because I figured people couldn't see this all the way up in the back. But just as a background about chloramine, the EPA had been studying chlorine and its disinfection byproducts for about 40 years. They decided that a chemical called trihalomethanes, which is formed when organic matter in surface waters, like our pristine mountain spring water from Hetch Hetchy, grows organic substances like algae. These things combine with chlorine and chloramine to form something called trihalomethanes. These were deemed by the EPA to be possible carcinogens. They decided that if you drink the water that contains trihalomethanes for your entire life, you have a 2.4% chance of developing bladder cancer. So they decided to regulate these trihalomethanes. They told utilities that have surface water as their water sources to lower trihalomethane concentrations. Utilities were given 14 choices for disinfection. They included several things separately and combinations, like UV light and chlorine as a residual, or UV light as a primary disinfectant and potassium permanganate as a residual disinfectant. What the utilities chose to do to lower the trihalomethanes in their treated water supplies was use chloramines, or chloramine. You can use those words interchangeably. They say they're using monochloramine, but chloramine always exists as a hydrolysis of three substances, mono, di, and trichloramine. So even if you control for pH and temperature and so forth, you still have the three species in hydrolysis, which means they shift back and forth between the species. Since utilities decided chloramine was the cheapest way to disinfect water supplies, they just went ahead and are converting across the U.S. Every utility that has surface waters will be expected to be in compliance this year. That means 90% of our utilities nationwide will be using chloramine as of this year. The only utilities that won't be using it are utilities that have groundwater sources only. Now, they could have groundwater sources and mix them with surface water sources, which they're having to do in many cities as the suburban areas grow and they have to import water supplies. And usually those are from the Delta or some other surface water source. So then they have to treat with chloramines or something else that will lower the trihalomethanes. When chloramine first went into our water supply, I was personally affected by it, even though I didn't know there was going to be a water disinfection change. I live in an apartment building in Menlo Park, and that city did not post any notices, and I don't receive a water bill, which was the usual way of announcing the water disinfection change. So I stepped into my shower on February 3rd at 4:30 in the afternoon, and within 3 minutes of showering, started coughing, wheezing, sneezing, and then having full-blown asthma which I'd never had before. Went to my doctor, reported the phenomenon. It was every time I showered, and then the reaction would persist for a couple days afterwards. I would also get the skin rashes and blisters, burning red skin, dry skin, bleeding, cracking skin. And I found when I drank the water, I got dry mouth, irritated esophagus, and digestive problems that seemed like IBS. But it was only when I drank the water. And we had been using bottled spring water at home. But if I went out with a friend for a cup of tea or coffee, I would notice that effect with drinking it about 4 to 5 hours later. So my doctor tried to figure out, he gave me every antihistamine product and nasal sprays and inhalers, and nothing worked. I was sick for about a month and a half when a friend called who hadn't seen me and said, "What's going on?" And I sounded like I had emphysema, because I was constantly exposed to the water through mainly bathing. And she said, "Do you think it could be the new water disinfectant?" And I said, "What water disinfectant?" She said, "Well, they're putting something new in the water. I don't know what it is, but you could call the city." And frankly, I was skeptical. I thought they couldn't put something in the water that would do this. But my doctor and I had eliminated all soaps, all shampoos, anything that had any chemicals in it whatsoever from our entire apartment. And still, any time I bathed in the water, I had this reaction. So I called the city, I called the SFPUC, who made the decision to use chloramines to treat the Hetch Hetchy water system, and they said, indeed, the day before my first shower, they had put chloramines into the water supply. I researched the issue, I talked to my doctor about it, and he went on the internet and looked at medical documentation. He found that chloramines do indeed irritate the skin and the respiratory tract, but usually at higher dosage levels. He recommended I avoid all the water. I started traveling to Morgan Hill or Gilroy to shower, brush my teeth, do my laundry, because even the clothes I washed in the chloraminated water irritated and made my skin itch. So this is a huge burden on my family. And when my case went into the newspapers, I started getting calls from hundreds of people who were having similar symptoms. The rashes, the respiratory problems, or the digestive problems, or a combination of them. And we tried to institute a lawsuit, but suing the city is a very difficult and pretty much thankless process. You have to go through a paperwork, a paper trail kind of wild goose chase. And lawyers are not interested in mainly pursuing that because they don't get really good compensation for their efforts. So what I did was form our group, Citizens Concerned About Chloramine, with about 25 people who were also experiencing symptoms. And we have now traveled around the Bay Area giving talks on the effects of chloramine and trying to work with our legislators to get chloramine out of our water system until the test studies that I found had never been conducted on the human health effects of chloramine were conducted. When I researched the issue, I found the EPA itself said no dermal studies or inhalant studies had ever been done. The cancer studies on chloramine were so limited, about 9 rat studies, rodent studies, that they were considered by the EPA to be inadequate for assessment. So we don't even know if it causes cancer on down the line. But the immediate effects for some people, the severe respiratory problems, are life-threatening. We are working with our lawmakers to try to get them educated about the respiratory effects. We have documented hundreds of cases now of people who have avoided all their water, either gone to other water systems out of town, or just done sponge baths and drink the bottled water. Bottled spring water is what we recommend because it's never been treated with a disinfectant. And they have documented that when they stay off the water for everything, including bathing and showering, their symptoms go away. And when they go back on the water, their symptoms return. In the process of researching the issue, I discovered that monochloramine, as used as a water disinfectant, will stay primarily monochloramine, even though it forms some di- and trichloramines, if the water is cold and it's not agitated, and the pH stays in a controlled range. However, If you heat the water for a bath or a shower, or you're cooking your pasta on your stove and the steam is in your air, or your dishwasher is venting steam, or your washer and dryer is venting steam, the steam mainly consists of di and trichloramines. Now, the research from the Centers for Disease Control and the Industrial Hygiene Association, and a new study from the Catholic University of Belgium at Louvain, have found that di and trichloramines are extreme respiratory toxins. They pull water out of the mucosa. They initiate an inflammatory reaction that looks like an allergic reaction, but actually is not. It's a chemical reaction. And it destroys respiratory mucosa through the excessive drying and the burning and irritation of that mucosa. This includes your eyes, your lips, your mouth, but especially your respiratory tract, because you're breathing mostly the di and trichloramines in the heated and aerosolized water. One way water systems get rid of di and trichloramines is to bubble air through it. That releases the gaseous di and trichloramines into the air and gets rid of them from the water. When you're showering, you are bubbling that water through a shower head and you're heating the water. Most people aren't showering in cold water. And that will release more of the di and trichloramines, which you then breathe in an enclosed space. And this comes from a study from the University of Pittsburgh, and Lillian, our secretary, has handed out this sheet, which has a little write-up of what their research found. Volatile chemicals in the water are coming out through heated water, especially when it's aerosolized. And so you're breathing toxic chemicals into your lungs. It's destroying your respiratory tract, and you're absorbing the chloramines into your bloodstream directly, so your digestive tract can't break them down. Monochloramine, they found, binds with the hemoglobin in your blood and prevents it from carrying oxygen. So we've heard of many people who are dizzy after showering and feel oxygen deprived. It also is a way of getting right directly into your cells through the bloodstream. If you drink or eat the chloraminated water in your food, say you boil pasta in it, you're eating mainly the ammonia stays in the water you boil. You may boil off the chlorine, but you concentrate the ammonia in the water you boil. So your pasta is a sponge for the ammonia, and you're getting this in your food. So when you're showering, I heard estimates that depending upon the volatility of the chemical, and di and trichloramines are extremely volatile, which means they're released into the air easily, especially under heat conditions or aerosolization. Your exposure to the chemicals in the water, in the tap water, is 600% more from showering and bathing than from drinking it. This is a lethal exposure when you're talking about especially trichloramines. Some people are more sensitive to it for reasons of age, genetics, and other predisposing factors. People with a more acid pH, as I was hearing, have a stronger reaction to it. There is a lady in Palo Alto here from the Bioenergy Balancing Center, and she did a little preliminary study, Priscilla Capel. She found that the chloramine people were drinking in their water prevented the bicarbonate from being released by the kidneys into the blood, caused your blood to get acid, caused the oxidation of manganese, caused you to not be able to absorb your vitamin D or your calcium, and in general upset your entire biochemistry. So this agrees with some of the preliminary things I'm seeing in people and have heard from people who even take supplements and have found they need much more now to maintain a healthy dose, and they didn't know why. Those of us who already have an acid system have noticed it's way out of control. So all the kinds of things that the disease states that are irritated by an acid system get worse. Now, some people are more affected than others. I happen to be one of the canaries in the coal mine. But even people who are really always been healthy, like my husband, has noticed the dry, itching skin every time he showers. And he'll have the sneezing kind of effect. What I discovered in the research, again, was when I looked at breathing studies of chloramines, 1 out of 5 people who are sensitive to chloramines inhaled will have an immediate reaction, followed by a delayed 8-hour resurgence of their symptoms. 4 out of 5 people who are sensitive don't have the immediate reaction. about 4 to 8 hours later, they get the respiratory symptoms. Sinus congestion, running nose, coughing, wheezing. One man, his doctor didn't know what to do. And he lived in a water system where they had well water only. But he showered 2 to 3 times a week at a gym near his work. And on the days he showered at the gym, that night, 8 hours later, he would wake up with terrible respiratory problems. He heard about our group. He tried avoiding showering at the gym. He'd been exposed for about a year before he decided to avoid his exposure at the gym, because it was only on the days that he showered there that he had this effect. And when he avoided showering there, all his symptoms left. And he found that over the year he was exposed, the symptoms got worse and worse and worse. It took about 2 months after he stopped showering for all of the symptoms to settle down. Now, in that study from the Catholic University of Louvain, the children who were swimming in indoor swimming pools breathing chloramines that came off the pool surface, which were formed because the pool is chlorinated and it combines with ammonia in the pool like sources like people's sweat, and it formed the monodi and trichloramines, and the children were breathing these, especially the di and trichloramines, which were in a vapor in the pool hall. Researchers found they had lung damage equivalent to heavy smokers. They identified 3 proteins that are associated with heavy smoking lung damage. They were shocked that water disinfectants had not been studied. They recommend further studies, but nothing's been done so far. Our water utilities are turning a deaf ear to this issue. They will say things like, well, chloramine's been used in this country since 1917 in a place like Denver. They won't tell you, however, that Denver was using 0.08 milligrams per liter, and our system was using 3.0 and reduced it to 2.7. That's about 300% lesser magnitude concentration. And people who have the symptoms notice concentration makes their symptoms vary, because when the utilities dose, they don't dose continually. They do a big dose and it levels off, and they do another big dose, and people's symptoms follow that pattern. So I guess I whet your appetite for this. There's a lot more information.
Very well done.
Thank you.
Well, you have the usual problem, and this is obviously a tremendously well done presentation. Very important subject, but you know, we can't get it all in. Maybe we should have a whole session on this. Maybe that's what we should do. So maybe we'll reschedule. But Bob?
Yeah, I wanted to say there's another major problem that you haven't even talked about, having to do with chloramine.
Yes.
I saw in Scientific American about a year ago a short article about how in Washington, D.C., the lead in the water is 24 times higher. Now, what happens when you live in a hard water area and the chlorine causes the deposition of the heavy metals like lead in the pipes?
Mm-hmm.
And when they add chloramine, it takes all that lead that has accumulated over 50 years in your water supply pipe, and suddenly it's being released into your water. So we're drinking water probably that has a high amount of lead and cadmium and things like that.
Yes. Washington, D.C. primarily had a lead water system. They were an older city, so most of their pipes were lead. There is a man, Mark Edwards, who works for Virginia Tech. He studied this issue. He is the one that told the EPA it was the chloramine leaching the lead at these high levels, and they fired him for his efforts. He's traveling around the U.S. now documenting, as they put chloramine in the water, what happens to the water. So yes, you're drinking a lot of lead. Even though we have a lot of copper pipes, they have the lead solder. So the lead solder is being leached. Your plumbing is leaking. One man lost $125,000 because all the pipes under his house were stripped of the lead solder, and he had a landslide. So he had massive property damage. And you are drinking the lead. You're also drinking the plasticizers from polymer pipes. And a lot of people have the plastic polymer pipes in their homes. And they're even thinking of putting polymer pipes in the Hetch Hetchy water system. Chloramine pulls the elasticizers out, which are horrific carcinogens. They make trihalomethanes look like a sneeze. They are horrible carcinogens, and that's being leached into your water. Plus, those pipes are being de-elasticized, made brittle, So they'll snap at the first earthquake or road work or whatever, and then massive property damage. Yes, rubber. Yes.
We'll schedule Denise, I think everybody, we'll schedule Denise to come back like in June or something like that, as soon as we can. And we'll spend the whole evening on this.
My phone number is on this flyer. If you get a copy of this flyer, I'm in the contact, and we do have research to substantiate everything, and if you're interested in pieces of that research, we can send it to you.
Go ahead.
She said that's exactly what it looks like. I'm getting them all over my body.
Well, you know, I tell you, this is really big. So, I mean, Jim was on the phone with me, Jim Karnstad, our video guy, today saying, you know, what do you know about eczema? I've suddenly got these things on my skin. I have no idea what's going on. Can you show them what it looks like, Jim?
Show them.
Yeah, there's all across there. It's on my sides now. Uh-huh. It's all over there. It's on my arms. And I have not had a skin problem at all, except for pimples as a teenager, in 60 years.
This is consistent with what people have shown us. Yeah. And it's cumulative, too, because the ammonia is building up on your skin. You're never washing in anything else. And ammonia is irritating to the skin. Mm-hmm. And the hypochlorous acid from the chloramine breakdown also irritates the skin.
Good
job. I've been using this shower head.
Do it for a couple days and then it's used up. We've had people go through many of those. The ones that are sensitive with the skin reactions, it doesn't work for respiratory reactions because the dye and trichloramines are released anyway. But for the skin sensitivity, people find relief for a couple of days and then they have to keep replacing the vitamin C and it gets very expensive.
Hey, listen, I'm going to cut off the discussion so we can do this, but we'll have Denise come back. By the way, as you can tell, she studied biochemistry, right?
No, I studied about 3 years at UCLA, and I was sensitive to the chemicals, so I left that field.
But only a whole house filter will solve.
Only a whole house filter, and then you can't guarantee it will remove all the chloramine and ammonia.
But I just want to put two more cents in here. I really think that a lawsuit can be brought, and you know, you're not probably going to get any action. You know, efficiently any other way. There is money to be made, and there are attorneys who work pro bono. So, I mean, you can bring a lawsuit on this. And you know, I think there are attorneys who, associations of attorneys who work pro bono and look for this kind of project.
But there's a problem under the government code, I think it's 910. You have to file a claim within the first 6 months, or you can file a late claim no later than 1 year.
Well, but the thing is, you can make a claim from the time you're injured.
Yes.
There's no problem. There's no shortage of clients who are going
to
be.
I've talked to 200
lawyers. Okay. Well, I still think it can be done.
The monetary aspect, just to inform all of Hetch Hetchy, would be $125,000 right from the start.
And what do you mean inform all about Hetch Hetchy?
To mail to everyone on Hetch Hetchy that this is possibly happening, so that they can contact him, is $125,000.
Well, he doesn't need everybody. He just needs 10 people to do a class action.
That's true.
Well, let's talk about this later.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, but I mean, you know, this is something that can be dealt with, and we got to just have to deal with it. But we'll do that. We'll work on that when you come back. Okay, now we'll take a break. Let's take a break. We usually take a 15-minute break. Let's take a 10-minute break because John McDougal has a long way to go home again or whatever, so we want to get back to 5 minutes. 5-minute break.
We're trying to study.